are so happy to have you here. We are honored to get to acknowledge your service, and we appreciate everything you have done for our country. We are very grateful here at Douglas School. We have a list of things on our agenda for today, and we will get started, and we have lots of things going on. Students, you all know what Veterans Day is. You know that you are to be respectful and quiet. If you don't have enough room for your legs, you can stretch them out a little bit. Please do not stay like that. You'll need to go right back to Indian style so that no one is touched by you, okay? I hurt. All right, the first order of business is we will, Mr. Morgan, who is a long-term substitute here, is going to help us post the colors along with our Douglas Cub Scout boys.
Please rise for the presentation of colors. Color guard, tin hut. Color guard, advance. Color guard, halt. Prepare to post the colors. Salute. Post the colors. Please join us in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
And to the Texas flag. Color guard, about face. Color guard, return to post. Color guard, halt. Color guard, about face. Color guard at ease. Please remain standing for the singing of the national anthem.
Served in the Army, Navy, Air Force, Marines, and National Guard. Coast Guard, both in times of war and peace. For nearly 100 years since the end of World War I, Veterans Day has given us a time to pay due respect to our veterans who have passed the torch of liberty from one generation to the next. Part of paying our respect means recommitting to our nation's sacred obligation to care for those, like these men and women here today, who have protected the freedom we often take for granted. I have pledged to provide our service members with the best equipment, resources, and support in the world. Support that must continue after they return to the civilian life as veterans. This is why veterans' health care is a top priority for my administration. I have signed legislation that improves accountability at the Department of Veterans Affairs and provides additional funding for the Veterans Choice Program, which ensures veterans continue to receive care in their communities from providers they trust. I've also signed legislation to give veterans GI Bill education benefits for their lifetime, and legislation to fix the VA appeals process to ensure veterans can access the resources they are rightly due. Additionally, this Veterans Day, more than 50 years from the beginning of the Vietnam War, I will be in Da Nang, Vietnam, with leaders of the Asian Pacific Economic Corporation Forum, as we discuss ways to improve economic relationships between the United States and Asia in a country where Americans and Vietnamese once fought a war. We are compelled to recall and recognize the sacrifices of more than 8 million Vietnam veterans who served here, beginning with those who arrived in the first American troop deployment in 1965, and ending with those who fought with ceasefire of 1973. These men and women dedicated themselves during one of the most challenging periods in our history to promoting freedom across the globe. Many spent years away from their loved ones as they endured the burdens of battle, and some experienced profound pain and anguish as their fellow warriors, more than 50,000 of them, lost their lives. Some of these heroes have yet to return home, as 1,253 of America's sons and daughters still remain missing. Along with our Vietnamese partners, however, we continue to work to account for them and to bring them home to American soil. We will not rest until the work is done. With respect for and in recognition of the contributions our service members have made to the cause of peace and freedom around the world, the Congress has provided 5 U.S.C. 6103A that November 11th of each year shall be set aside as a legal public holiday to honor our nation's veterans. As Commander-in-Chief of our heroic armed forces, I humbly thank our veterans and their families as we remember and honor their service and their sacrifice. Now, therefore, I, Donald J. Trump, President of the United States of America, do hereby proclaim November 11th, 2017 as Veterans Day. I encourage all Americans to recognize the fortitude and sacrifice of our veterans through public ceremonies and private thoughts and prayers. I call upon federal, state, and local officials to display the flag of the United States and to participate in patriotic activities in their communities. I call on Americans, including civic and fraternal organizations, places of worship, schools, and communities, to support this day with commemorative expressions and programs. In witness whereof, I have hereunto set my hand this seventh day of November, in the year of our Lord, 2017, and of the independence of the United States of America, the 242nd. At this time, we will introduce the guest we have today. And boys and girls, if you are in the choir and you have not made your way back to your family member or your guest, would you please do that at this time? We might need to squeeze in a few more chairs, Mr. Morgan. Thank you. we call your name, would you please stand along with your guest from Douglas School? And then we are going to call out every single name. We were trying to make sure we had accounted for everyone who signed up. There may be some on this list who were not able to make it today, but we will call their name anyway and go ahead just as if they were here. And boys and girls, if you're in the audience and your guest did not get to come today, you may go ahead and stand up when I call their name. Okay? The first person is Jerry Brady, U.S. Air Force, guest of Kylie Anderson. Ricardo Chavarria, U.S. Army, Master Sergeant, guest of Nathaniel Chavarria. Stand up, please. Jim Cole, U.S. Army, Specialist First Class, Kylie Jo Anderson. Joe Cordova, U.S. Marines, Corporal Coral Perez. Joseph Cox, U.S. Army, Staff Sergeant, E6, guest of honor. He is the guest of Lauren Dittrich. Jason Doss, U.S. Army, E5 Sergeant, guest of Lance Banks. Bo Dyer Sr., U.S. Army, E5 Sergeant, guest of Bo Dyer. Concepcion Garcia, U.S. Navy, Petty Officer Second Class. He is the guest of Giovanni Garcia. Gerald Hurd, U.S. Army, E5, he is the guest of Luke Gomez. Austin Henson, U.S. Marines, Corporal, the guest of Tanner Henson. Doug Lewis, U.S. Air Force, Sergeant, and he is the guest of Jaden McDonald. Lorette Lewis, U.S. Army, PFC, Jaden McDonald, is the guest. We have Lorette Lewis, U.S. Army, PFC.
Private First Class, right?
Private First Class, Braylon Savage. We have Brad Malone, U.S. Army, E6, the guest of Reese Malone. We have Paul Malone, U.S. Army, E5, the guest of Reese Malone. M.G. Mitchell, United States Air Force, Corporal, the guest of Sidney Mitchell. Ray Moreland, U.S. Navy. Chief Officer. And he is the guest of Miss Moreland. We have Billy Perkins, who was unable to attend. He is in the U.S. Army, and he was the guest of Lexi Logan. Lauren Reeves, U.S. Navy, E4 Petty Officer Third Class, Madison Dixon. Robles, U.S. Marines, Lance Corporal, and the guest of Brianna Ruiz. James Ross, U.S. Army, Private First Class, and he is the guest of Larson Ross. Norman Sanders, U.S. Navy, E-5. He is the guest of Cash Gamblin. James Smith, U.S. National Guard, E-4, the guest of Abigail Tate. Kyle Smith, U.S. Air Force, the guest of Bo Dyer. Red Smith, U.S. Marines, Corporal, and he is the guest of Dottie Smith. U.S. Army, Sergeant and Communication Specialist. He is the guest of Avery Pearson and Ivan Smith. Lewis Tatum, U.S. Navy, E-5, and he is the guest of Laney Tatum. Joe Thompson, U.S. Army, Corporal, and he is the guest of Emerson Thompson. Andrew Watson, U.S. Army Specialist, and he is the guest of Wyatt Watson. Caleb Watson, U.S. Army Private First Class, is also Wyatt Watson. Grayson Wing, U.S. Army, E-4, Noah Perez. And we added one, Mike Gill. This was the girls. He was in the U.S. Army as a sergeant, and the U.S. Navy as a Petty Officer 3rd Class, and he is the guest of Audrey Tanney. Two ranges of service, that's commendable, thank you. Did I have anyone that's here that is not on our list? Please stand up. No. Mr. Tatum, did I say Lewis Tatum? Okay, kind of had a brain freeze there for a moment. Thought I called you Richard Smith. Thank you for your service. One more round of applause. opportunity to share with your students what patriotism, freedom. This opportunity to share with your students what freedom, patriotism, and the flag means to me. Thank you again, veterans. We can never say thank you enough for your service to our great country. I'm grateful that you are home safely from your tours overseas. Mrs. Bomber's already told us about how Veterans Day began, and it is now celebrated on November the 11th. Right now, we have 18 million veterans living in the United States of America, with 1.6 million of those being women. What is freedom? It is a state of being free. Freedom is unselfishly given to us, the American citizen, by many men and women who joined our military ranks, both during peacetime and wartime. Many were drafted. That means our government called them to serve, to train and serve and go to a foreign land. Saying no was not an option. Today, only 1% of our population voluntarily join to serve in our military. They serve in the Army, the Navy, the Air Force, Marines, Coast Guard, and our National Guard. The root word of freedom is free. Our freedom as the American citizen is not free. Allow me to introduce to you a soldier who sacrificed his life for our freedoms. This is Staff Sergeant Michael Chadwick Lloyd, and he is mine and Jimmy's son. He was killed on August 12, 2006 in Baghdad, Iraq. Chad was just like you, a student, a son, a grandson, a friend, and he loved to play soccer. At age 18, Chad did not know what he really wanted to do with his life. So on January the 2nd, 2001, he joined the ranks of the United States Army. At the onset of the Operation Iraqi Freedom conflict, Chad was assigned to the 4th ID as a Humvee commander and sent to Baghdad, Iraq. There, he was instrumental in the troops' occupation and successful operations out of Patrol Base 2. On August 12, 2006, while out on patrol, Chad and fellow soldier Staff Sergeant Kevin Siegler saw a wire that was running along the ground. Instead of putting their younger soldiers' lives at risk, they volunteered to follow and find out where this wire led to. And it led to a booby trap, to a bomb. It detonated as upon their presence. Chad was killed instantly from the bomb's blast. The days that followed are truly a blur, but the citizens of Hopkins County and Sulphur Springs mourned with us. They lined the streets with the American flags as we said our final goodbye to Chad. As painful as this journey has been, his sacrifice was the catalyst for the beginning, the dream, the construction of the Hopkins County Veterans Memorial, which is located down on our square. It honors all men and women who were born, raised, or buried in Hopkins County. If you get a chance, I beg you to go and look at it. Pay homage to all the names that are on those walls. What is patriotism? It is a love or devotion to one's country. Even as a youngster, I had a sense of pride when I heard the Pledge of Allegiance or I heard the Star Spangled Banner being played. Patriotism is constant. It's a deep down in your heart feeling of love and commitment. Imagine being in a foreign country with your fellow soldiers and your friends where the natives of that country are hunting you down to rid you by bullets and bombs, every day, every night. But the American soldier gets up every morning to face the enemy. The question to our veterans, would you do it all over again? Of course you would. They sacrificed all of their tomorrows for our todays. Their lives exemplify the motto, duty, honor, and country. It is the veteran who prays the most for peace because they have seen and witnessed the terror and tragedy of war. So how can you share your patriotism to our country? I'm sharing with you a poem. It's written by a staff sergeant in the U.S. Army, but it was written many years ago. It is entitled, "I Am Your Flag." So I will be speaking as if I am the flag. Hello, remember me? Some people call me Old Glory, while others call me the Star-Spangled Banner. But whatever you call me, I am your flag, the flag of the United States of America. Something has been bothering me, so I need to have a talk with you, because it is between you and me. Not too long ago, people were lining the streets on both sides as the parade went by, and naturally, I was leading that parade, proudly waving in the breeze. And when your daddy saw me coming, he took his hat off and placed it over his heart so that his right hand would be over his heart. And you were standing there with your sister, right next to him. Both of you had your right hand over your heart. What has happened now? I don't feel as proud as I used to. I'm still the same old flag. I see children running around and playing, shouting. They don't seem to know or care who I am or what I stand for. I saw an elderly man take his hat off one day, but he turned around as the other men kept their hats on. He walked away. I'm still the same old flag. You stars have been added since those parades long ago. A lot of blood has been shed. Is it a sin to be patriotic anymore? Have you forgotten who I am? What I stand for and where I've been? Guadalcanal, Pearl Harbor, the Twin Towers, Vietnam, Iraq, Afghanistan? At the Memorial Honor Roll of all names, all of those that never came back, they gave their lives for this great nation to be free under God. When you salute me, you salute each and every one of them. It won't be long now, and I'll be coming down that street, leading the parade, and proudly waving in the breeze. So when you see me coming, stand up straight and salute, and I'll salute you back by waving. And then I'll know that you remember. In closing, I cannot stress the importance of the cost of freedom and for you to have a patriotic spirit and love for our great country. When you see someone on the street, in uniform, at the mall, at a restaurant, at a ball game today, take their hand, shake it, and tell them thank you. I not only encourage you, but I challenge you to be the next generation that stands up and demonstrates the proper respect due to our American flag, our national anthem, and our veterans. This picture was actually taken on August 11th, 2006. It was taken the day before Chad was killed, and it was found on his iPad when all of his items were returned. This picture was right after he graduated from basic training, and that was his red car that he loved. He had come home to visit us one weekend, and so appropriately we had the flag waving and him in uniform. This picture here was when he first went into basic training, and he sent us this picture, and it's kind of like how it is when the young guys go off to be going to basic training, right? Kind of put all your gear on and take a picture and smile real big, even though you wonder what's going on down deep. This picture was taken, I believe, in March of 2006. Chad left, actually, our last Christmas with Chad and his family was in December 2005. And then he left for Iraq, got to come home for a two-week R&R in March, and so that picture was taken. Jimmy had gone down, I believe, to Killeen to see him there. And so that picture was taken with Jimmy, March 2006. This is a picture of Chad and his buddies, fellow soldiers back in Iraq, and they were just taking, a time out before they went back to patrol. This is Chad with his son, JT, and I don't know, many of you probably, your kids don't remember, but some of your teachers might remember. Jimmy and I had the opportunity to keep JT. When Chad went on his first deployment, JT was 6 months old, and there he is at his birth. And then this was the last time that Chad came home in March of 2006 with his son, JT. And then this is the picture. There is an organization that goes and puts the combat boots. They travel around the country, put the combat boots out to memorialize the fallen soldiers. And this one is the one that goes around the nation in memory of our son, Chad Lloyd. Thank you. Thank you, Dina. And we will now have a moment of silence. Thank you. Our next guest is Mrs. Wiggins. This is Becky Wiggins, and she is the mother-in-law of our Miss Wiggins. Today, Ms. Wiggins is a retired school teacher, and she is here today to share a story called America's White Table with you all. Raise your hand if you have ever heard or have seen this book. Okay. This is a children's book written for days like this, Memorial Day, Veterans Day, and it's to honor the veterans and the soldiers who serve our country. And so we will turn this over to Ms. Wiggins.
Thank you. This lady right here. Okay, I'm so glad to be here today with y'all to read this story. It's called America's White Table. I have a table set up here, and when you leave today, I think she's going to make arrangements for you to walk by the table so you can see everything that's up here. It was just a little white table, but it brought tears of pride to Uncle John's eyes the Veterans Day he came for dinner and stood by, except for one person. Even though no one would be eating at it, my country, 'tis of thee. It was just a little white table, but earlier that day, Mama had told Gretchen, Samantha, and me the little table that we were setting for Veterans Day was just like the ones that had stood across America in the dining halls of the Army, the Navy, Marine Corps, Air Force, and since the Vietnam War ended. The table honors the men and women who serve in America's armed forces, especially those missing in action, our MIAs, and those held prisoner of war, our POWs. Sweet land of liberty. It was just a little white table, but it felt as big as America when we helped Mama put each item on it, and she told us why each thing was so important. We use a small table, girls, she explained first, to show one soldier's lonely battle against many. We cover it with a white cloth to honor a soldier's pure heart when he answers his country's call. We place a lemon slice and grains of salt on the plate to show a captive soldier's bitter fate and tears of families waiting for loved ones to return, she continued. We push an empty chair to the table for the missing soldiers who are not here. We lay a black napkin for the sorrow of captivity and turn over a glass for the meal that won't be eaten, she said. We place a white candle for peace and finally a red rose in a vase tied with a red ribbon for the hope that all of our missing will return someday. Mama finished speaking just as the sunlight spilled on the table and filled the overturned glass. I'll be I seen. It was just a little white table. But it suddenly made me want to burst with the thinking I couldn't explain when Mama told us how much our setting the white table would mean to Uncle John that night. Then she told us something that we didn't know. Our Uncle John, who gave us big bear hugs and spun us with airplane twirls and called me his Katy girl, was a POW in Vietnam before we were born. That's prisoner of war. It was just a little white table, but it gave us the courage to ask Mama what happened to Uncle John in Vietnam. And she quietly told us his story. When Uncle John served in Vietnam, he was sent on a rescue mission, and his helicopter was shot down behind the enemy lines, she began. Land where my fathers died. And he and his three crew members were taken prisoners. One crew member named Mike had serious wounds from the crash, but Uncle John and the other men tried to help Mike get better and persuaded the guard to bring Mike some medicine. Then one day, when a guard looked away, Uncle John and the others had a chance to escape, but Mike was still too sick to go, so Uncle John stayed behind, because he wouldn't leave a fellow soldier alone so far from home. Land of the Pilgrim's Pride. But how did Uncle John get free, we asked Mama. Sometime later, Uncle John had a chance to escape again, and somehow he was able to take Mike with him, carrying him on his back and collecting just enough rainwater and big leaves to keep them alive until Uncle John found an American infantry unit to help them. But even Uncle John did everything he could to bring Mike home alive. Mike's wounds were just too serious, and he died before the rescue helicopter got there. I know that Mike was only 20 years old, and he dreamed of playing football, but he loved America enough to give his life to his country when duty called. And I know how much Uncle John loves America, too, when he learned that helping Mike, that a soldier risked his life for a fellow soldier, because the best of your country lives in every man and woman who would lay down their life for you, too, from every mountainside. It was just a little white table, but it needed words of gratitude, like Mama's Thanksgiving. So before Uncle John arrived for dinner, Gretchen and Samantha and I decided to put three gifts of our own on the table to honor our veterans. Gretchen colored pictures of all the objects on the table, and Samantha wrote out words of my country, 'tis of thee, as a tribute to in song. I didn't know what a 10-year-old girl, could ever put on that table that was important as each veteran's gift of freedom to me. It was just a little white table, but I looked at it all dinner long, and in the quiet inside me, I could almost hear the silent soldiers at the empty chair saying, remember us, please. We are real people like your Uncle John and Mike, who left families and friends, homes and dreams of our own, to protect the birthright of liberty from disappearing as easily as sunlight from glass. Let freedom ring. It was just a little white table. But it took my words away when I hugged Uncle John goodnight and wanted to thank him for serving our country so bravely. So I just hugged him even harder and told him I loved him. Uncle John hugged me back even harder than I loved him. And that's when I knew what I wanted to put on the table. My promise to put the words from my heart into a little book about America's white table. And in the book, I've used Gretchen's pictures and Samantha's song, and Mama's story, and Uncle John and his friend Mike, because I hope that everyone who read it would set a white table on Veterans Day, so the brave Americans the little table honors won't ever feel forgotten by the country they love so much. Then in the salt, and on the little white table, I traced in the grains of their family's tears what each man and woman who serves America is to me, a hero. And that's when I saw the tears of pride fill my Uncle John's eyes. Thank you.
feel pretty patriotic. Me too. We have a couple of tokens of appreciation for our ladies today. Ms. Wiggins, thank you very much for your help. We appreciate you very much. And Ms. Lloyd, these are for you. You will also receive a copy of the book, America's Wine Table, to share with your grandchildren. We thank you for attending. We are honored that you chose to spend part of your morning with us. We have a reception in the library. We have cookies and punch for you and your Douglas guest, okay? We also have, we will dismiss everyone in just a minute, but Ms. Lloyd has graciously accepted to close us with a word of prayer.
Assemble here and that we can honor and memorialize those who have given their lives and those who are continuing to give their lives today on foreign soils. God, please be with them. Keep them safe. Be with their families back home here in America. Father, we don't ever want to take our freedoms for granted. And Father, we know that our freedom was also bought through your Son, Jesus Christ, who died on the cross for our sins. Thank you, Father, for salvation. Thank you again for our veterans who are in attendance today. Father, may we be the shining light in this world, in this country, in this town, for what your love represents. Forgive us for our sins in your Son's precious and holy name.